Good afternoon, everyone, ladies and gentlemen. So I think I'll just start off straight away. We are short of time, I guess. So the context has been set in the first session. A lot has been spoken. I'll just pick the threads from there, and I'll first introduce myself. I'm Shrikant Suresh Kumar, lead distributed generation from AMP Energy. AMP Energy India is the Indian arm of the Canadian company AMP Energy, and we have our footprint across India doing on-site and off-site projects, and currently we operate in the on-site, rooftop, ground-mounted, utility and the open access, all three segments across India. So I'm handling the business development in South. Moving on and coming to the topic. So Karnataka has shown the way ahead to the country previously. I take example of the 2014 order in which the open access charges exemptions was given. That order came with a 10-year visibility, and we all saw what happened. It directly enabled a very big market of open access until 2018, and a lot of developers were able to add significant capacity under that regime. So all I'm saying is Karnataka has been at the forefront of giving clarity. That has happened before. We would just like that kind of a clarity should be given even at the current situation, where we are at a crossroads, where December a decision comes out from KERC, wherein they have put in their efforts and tried to define new business models, most of which keeps the DISCOM at the center of the action. While in the morning session, Mr. Dinesh Babu clarified that such a business model was suggested keeping in mind certain segments. However, I think on ground, it has given a different turn to the business, and I'll let the panel here weigh in on that topic even more. So that's one aspect that we will definitely be talking about, as to how this December order is affecting the business currently in and that's a very Karnataka specific thing. When some other states are going in various other directions, Karnataka has charted out a different direction altogether. So that's one. The second thing being the current economic situation that we are all in. It's a time when companies, the CNI segment, is looking at their sustainable efforts and looking at their profitability as such. So the OPEX model was one of the models where it was allowing the CNI segment to focus on their core business and allow the power sale and the solar efforts to be financed and the capital to come from the developer. This current development from KERC is basically hitting right at that model, and with charges, with permissions may not be granted for third party investments. So in a way, it's also in one direction hampering the growth of the CNI segment, which eventually will lead to an effect, cascading effect on the economic growth of the state itself. So that's the other aspect that I would want the panel to weigh in on. So moving on, I think we can start I would request each of the panelists to just pitch in with their views on the topics, and also add whatever points you would like to have on this topic.
So I probably would start off taking the view of the playing the devil's advocate, since the session moderator requested, you know, we can come in with the DISCOM's view. Look, I mean, obviously all of us were up in arms when KERC passed this order in December, but I think none of us are surprised. It is a true fact that DISCOMs are facing heavy revenue loss, especially at the back of the third-party exemptions which were given in Karnataka at least. And this scenario continues to play out across the country. Wherever it is feasible for solar, there is definitely a revenue loss for DISCOMs who are losing out their best customers. So I think from a developer and a industry standpoint, we also should take responsibility that we have been slightly naive, because this what we call the utility spiral, that as more and more people move to solar, the DISCOMs or the utility face ever mounting revenue losses. This was bound to happen. This has happened in Germany, this has happened in Australia, it's happening in the US now. So for us to close our eyes and just keep on building capacity and assuming that the government will continue to support us because, you know, Prime Minister has given such a target, was, you know, slightly naive. So I think the next step forward, the logical step forward for industry, is to work with the DISCOMs and educate them, obviously, but also come up with an equitable sharing model. Because unlike, or luckily, the lucky part is, unlike, you know, other countries, our DISCOMs are owned by the government. So they do have a social mandate which they have to fulfill, which is to give cheap power or free power to our farmers, where, you know, that was also given because, you know, food security is primary responsibility of the government, and quite frankly, it's more important than, say, giving cheap power to industry. That was the thought behind it. So I think as a next step, definitely we should educate DISCOMs and the government as a whole, what is the benefit of, let me stick to rooftop solar, in terms of reducing transmission loss, in terms of reducing energy usage within the facility, in terms of diesel abatement. If you just take the example of diesel abatement, I think one of the panelists in the first panel was mentioning, Karnataka does not allow you to sync your rooftop solar to your DG because of safety reasons, or, you know, and so this would not fall under the mandate of, say, a BESCOM to reduce diesel generation. But if you just take a conservative estimate, I think 5% of our energy in India is produced by DG gensets, which are dirty, they're noisy, and are not really efficient, and primarily used by people where power availability is an issue. But this would not come under the mandate of a DISCOM, but say a petroleum department or a natural resources department who is driving so many initiatives to reduce our foreign exchange outflow. If you tell them, you know, using solar can reduce your diesel consumption and saving us precious foreign exchange, then you get them into the conversation. So I think these are some of the things we need to look at holistically. I don't think there's even been a white paper in India showing how rooftop solar can reduce transmission loss, delay capex, which was the initial reason why DISCOMs got interest in solar. You know, they don't need to upgrade their transformers every few years, because you have rooftop solar picking up some of that peak load. So I think industry that way needs to and should have already worked on few of these issues to allay the fears of the DISCOM, and I think we could have delayed this very draconian measures that KERC has taken now and MERC has also taken now, and I'm sure it's going to spread across the country. Already Tamil Nadu is not exactly encouraging of rooftop solar. So that's my two cents, and look forward to the other panelists' views.
Yeah, I completely agree with what Siddharth said so far. I think, yes, the developers are equally to be blamed for what's going on, or not blamed, I'd say equally, are equal stakeholders in what's happening in Karnataka today. And, you know, as far as spreading awareness goes, I think it's up to us now to tell the DISCOM and to inform, and like you said, like publish white papers and tell them that, look, there are some benefits to rooftop solar that you may avail. For example, like you said, you know, delay capex investments. And also, you know, there are other things coming up, like using nighttime solar to balance out the grid. They're doing it in the UK. We all thought solar was only helpful in the morning, but no, you can use it to balance the grid at night by producing reactive power. These are things that we are not yet using in this country, and we can surely do that. From clean tech solar's perspective, you know, we investors, the one thing that as investors we really, do not look forward to is any kind of market uncertainty. We would love to keep investing in the market here. That's what we are here to do. The only problem we face is uncertainty. And with investors like Royal Dutch Shell and the Swiss Sovereign Fund, you know, the money isn't going anywhere. They're long-term investors. The one thing that really scares them is uncertainty. And like Siddharth said, you know, the Karnataka regulation a few years ago, that was a very clear regulation. We too did our first government project in Karnataka. As a matter of fact, 75% of our portfolio, which is the largest in Asia and in India, as far as CNI is concerned, is on the rooftop. We are not, we were not big players in the utility scale market. We are now. But, you know, because of that regulation, it opened up a whole gamut of opportunities for us because of the certainty that it represented, which is gone now. We hope that going forward, other states do not adopt, like you say, draconian measures. And also, we hope that there is some kind of an underlying principles-based regulation that comes out rather than very specific things. Like, you know, if you read in this regulation, there was this one line that I completely agreed with, and I think is by USolar. It says, what does an ERC have to do with how a solar plant is financed? I completely agree. And in my humble opinion, I do not understand. So a more principle-based thing where they actually tell us rather than what to do, why they want to do something and how they want to go about it, I think that would help. And then, yes, the onus is up to the developers to figure out ways. Like, you know, on the topics list, I saw smart policies. Yes, smart policies, but how do smart policies happen? We shouldn't wait for the ERCs to come up with them. As developers, it's our responsibility to come up with suggestions of smart policies. Like, for example, coupling solar with EV technologies, coupling with load side management, right? Clean tech solar, every plant we put up on a rooftop is standardized throughout Southeast Asia. So whatever plant we install in India looks exactly the same like the one we install in Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, all eight countries. The way we do that is because, one, standardization helps us to get the investments in, and two, standardization helps us to understand technologies that are not yet prevalent in every geography. So for example, even in states which have net metering, we use a very high-tech SCADA system. If you guys want to understand what it is, we've got a data team sitting right there. They're based out of Bangalore. You know, people talk about string level monitoring, we want to cell level monitoring. All these things we could use and we could, present to the government as transparent data and help them with the regulations, policies, and basically ways out. Lastly, I think, yes, storage will change everything. Hopefully, that's the technical answer to all our problems in this country. But then again, that's yet to be seen, and hopefully we'll get to parity soon with storage. Thanks.
I think Karnataka is one of the leading player when it comes to rooftop. They introduced a net metering with 9.56 rupees rate in 2015-16. And I think that's where even many states in India even not even encouraging net metering. So if you look at that rooftop, I think now we may be having around 300 megawatt out of 5 gigawatt in Indian market share. And yes, there are challenges in terms of, is all our BESCOM or DISCOM engineer efficient in reading meter issues? No. There are a lot of problem we face as many clients, they don't get the proper revenue from their generation. All the challenges are there, and the developers in bigger rooftops now picking up in our ESCO models. As a Enerman, we provide a monitoring solution for a rooftop around 100 plus sites. So we are providing it, plus we work with many of these developers. As a O&M service provider, we are doing around 100 plus megawatt O&M. There are a lot of challenges in terms of when it comes to roof, say the safety aspect, and when it comes to the the ownership of the assets, asset owner, say somebody else, roof owner, somebody else, and access to those roofs to provide a service is always a challenge. And roof, there is no guaranteed, utility available, power available. So there is a lot of loss, and when DG synchronization is not permitted, then there is a further performance issues when it comes to your asset. So a lot of challenges are there, and policy also evolving. I think we all need to work towards how do we address each one of it. And I don't think we should blame anybody, including the problem of DISCOM. They have to handle it on their own. Revenue loss is their problem. I think still all of us has a shortage of power. I think that's is a big, still gap is high. So with a storage hope that will be addressed to store more during the day and for the utilization in the night. I think everybody, what I know, the pain points are there from developer side. Yes, who is making money? I don't know who is making money. As a service provider are not making money, investor are not making money, and discoms are losing money. I don't know. So I think we need to collectively solve it. I think hope this some panel members will address that point of. Yes, thank you.
I'll just pitch in here maybe. So what we are hearing from the first three of our panelists is basically that discoms can very well take our help from the developer side. We have the data, we have certain ideas that would probably be beneficial for the discoms also. All that we are asking as an industry is the discoms can get us involved in the conversation rather than look at the developers as a competition. So if probably we start in that direction, I think a lot of effort has already been done, especially in Bangalore in the past 3-4 years, in trying to tell the discoms that the net metering regulations and the RESCO models, the OPEX models are not going to, yes, it will seem like it's going to hit on the revenues, but then these models are eventually what is enabling solar to come up in a big way. So it would be good if the discoms can actually collaborate with the developers, and we are very much willing to look into that. Probably we'll continue with the panelists.
So I'm Srikant. I'm from Tata Cleantech Capital, and I come from lending background. And just to concur with what Ankur has said, any market uncertainty actually creates a confusion, not only in investors who are putting up their money in developers, IPPs, but also lenders who actually fund 65% to 70% of the project cost. So we had a very strong belief that rooftop sector is going to come up in a big way in the next few years. And accordingly, we had a 100 million line of credit from Green Climate Fund, which would help us to enable and fund rooftop projects across segments. So earlier we were focusing mostly on C&I segment with RESCO model. And in fact, if I have to look at my portfolio, almost 100%, almost 99% is RESCO, C&I, plus 1% is only CAPEX loan. So what we have been doing is, what other IPPs have been doing is, we've been trying to evolve and we've been trying to look at a model where which has been working for us in the last 2-3 years. And going forward also, we also believe that this model is going to evolve in a big manner. So far, as far as the lending market is concerned, so we've been slow compared to what we emphasized in the last 1 year, because we were trying to figure out how to finance in the traditional way of funding rooftop projects. But what we have figured it out is that if we go the conventional way of lending, we'll not be able to achieve whatever scale that we are looking at in terms of lending to rooftop segment. So what we internally have decided and taken a call that we should have a clear-cut system developed. We have to leverage on whatever technology that we can, and try to see if we can decrease whatever TAT that we are looking at in terms of sourcing till disbursement. If we can do it, say, within 1 month of time frame, that would actually help turning whatever leads that we are getting from various sources into proper disbursement. So far, last 1 year we've been slow. We have just figured out this framework that we need to develop systems wherein we'll be able to leverage on whatever experience that we have in utility scale and rooftop scale, and collaborate with various EPC players and IPPs, and try to arrive at a model where the funding can happen in similar lines to what is being done in, say, housing segment. And what we also feel is that whatever regulations that have come up recently in Karnataka, so there could be an opportunity for us to collaborate with, say, a DISCOM like BESCOM. We might not prefer other DISCOMs, and understand, and we can help them in terms of financing, where they can aggregate various rooftop projects and give us a portfolio, and we might look at financing that. But since there is going to be a 25-year PPA with various consumers. So that way, I think from a lender's point of view, we are still very risk-focused. But even if these kind of changes happen, we are very much ready to do rooftop lending. And we are very clear that we'll be able to achieve at least 1,000 crores of lending business in the next 2 to 3 years, especially in this rooftop segment. So that way, we are concerned, but we're not overly concerned, and we're also not very surprised, as Siddharth has already pointed out. So this is bound to happen because a lot of capacity has come in open access. So loss of C&A customers might have possibly made KERC to come up with this policy. So that's it. I mean, from a lender's point of view, if there is any question, then I'll answer it.
So I guess from the lender's point of view, they are somewhat less affected by this current regulation, in the sense they will continue to lend. Maybe the party may not be just the developers. It could become the DISCOMs also.
It could become a DISCOM owned, utility owned, in that or direction. Consumer owned, but utility aggregated. Whatever right. suits us.
You need to lend. So yes. You can lend to more parties now. That's how you're looking at it.
Whatever tariff that BESCOM has given or KERC has given at this point of time, whether it is going to be workable from our point of view is what we need to look at.
Right.
So, right. So 3 rupees 8 paisa or 3 rupees 7 paisa, whether it's going to work.
That's everybody's working, individual companies, internal working. Yeah, agreed.